I have access.
A short introduction of myself. One moment. Yeah, there we go. Well, my name is Intian Kuindersma. I'm living in the Netherlands, in Europe, so to speak. I'm a speaker at Access conferences at Karl's Place in Vienna, for instance, but I also visited those conferences in Hanover and Köln, and also in the Dutch version in Amsterdam. There once was a Access conference and I was a speaker there as well. I am a long-term software developer. I'm a freelance software developer since 1986 already, so I started with DBase. But then I quickly moved to Access. As soon as I discovered Access, I was sold right away. I just moved into it directly. And ever since, I've been working with databases. So all kinds of database systems, SQL Server, of course, MySQL, of course, and then all kinds of reporting tools as well. So reporting in Access, of course, but also Crystal Reports, also SQL Server reporting service. And since 2015, I'm also passionate about Power BI. So that's why I said some Power BI things already before, although I meant Power Automate. So, but that's my personal problem. I'm working with Power BI most of my time actually at the moment. But I also like to present new things or to find out new things. So Power Automate Desktop is one of those new things that came along, and I really wanted to work with this. And then I started also presenting on it because that's, I think, it's the best way for me personally to get to know and to get to work with the tool. To say, okay, I present on this, and then you'll have to dive into it and learn a lot of things yourself as well. So tonight I'm your speaker on Power Automate Desktop. And well, of course, I will start with telling you all about what it is, actually. I mean, you heard about Power Automate, for instance, I guess. And before, I had a little talk already. And one of the things I would ask you, do you know Power Automate, actually? Is this something you have heard about? I mean, Power Automate in the cloud, for instance. Does anybody of you has experiences with this? Is this a completely new world, this complete automation? Somebody wants to say something? No. Okay, well, even if you know Power Automate in the cloud, I will tell you Power Automate Desktop is something completely different. You have automation in the cloud with Power Automate. So if you have Office 365, you will also have Power Automate, even if you don't know it. But as soon as you have an Office 365 account, you are free to use Power Automate, which means that you're able to say, for instance, react to emails coming in, or to new documents being saved to a document library. That's the kind of thing you would do with Power Automate in a cloud. Yeah, but Power Automate Desktop is something completely different. It's a tool that you have to install on your laptop, and you can perform all kinds of tasks on your laptop. Yeah, so you can launch Windows applications, you can launch web applications, you can do all kinds of things within those applications. I mean, you can just click buttons, you can drag your mouse, you can do whatever, with as if you were using the software yourself, so to speak. So that's why this RPA comes from, robotic process automation. Yes, this is really what we're going to see this evening. You make a software program do the work for you. So what would be normal use cases for something like this? Well, we all have things that we do very often, I guess, on the internet or on our desktop. Copying files, downloading certain files from a website, uploading things to another website. I mean, all those things that you do on a regular basis that might be candidates for automating through Power Automate Desktop. Yeah. Microsoft itself says, well, one of the applications might be moving data around. If you have some kind of old legacy application in your firm, and this doesn't have a web API or whatever, so the only way you have to enter data is to just type those data in there. Then Power Automate might be the thing that would do it for you, because it can take data from one software package, move to the other one, and just type it in the boxes, the text boxes, the list boxes, the check boxes, whatever you want, and just press OK in the other application. So for moving data around, for instance, it might be also be a very nice tool. So, and then of course there is the question, does this make sense for XS developers, or is it even a competition for them? I mean, that's a very interesting question, I guess, but hopefully we could talk about this later on as well. I mean, we as XS developers, well, most of us are XS developers, we are using VBA to do this kind of things, but VBA of course is not good in working with JSON, or not good with working with web services, or downloading files from the internet, or that kind of thing, or even clicking on buttons in other software programs. I mean, you couldn't use XS to move along the buttons of Word. I mean, you have the Word object model, but you can't click on things like Power Automate Desktop can do. So is it something that XS developers should be afraid of? I don't know. I think they fit very well together. But as soon as you have a new project, you might consider not programming any VBA for certain tasks because Power Automate Desktop is there for you to do the kind of things. And there are so many connectors to things that XS doesn't know about. So it might be very sensible to do it this way. Yeah, but I will show a lot of those things afterwards. One of the things that's very useful telling you is that it's now included for free with Windows 10. So Microsoft is really pushing this software and making it really affordable, actually. I mean, I will tell you about some costs afterward, but the Power Automate Desktop software itself is free of charge. Yeah. One more thing about Power Automate Desktop. I mean, I just took a quote from TechCrunch, and they called Power Automate Desktop, they call it a macro recorder on steroids. Yeah, and one of the things that makes it very special is that it has 370 pre-built actions in it, which you would have to program yourself in XS, but which are there already. And I will show a lot of them afterwards. So as I told you, it's not Power Automate as you know it from the cloud. It's a completely different experience. Yeah, well, I will show you. And so I don't talk too much about this one. Microsoft did not program this software actually themselves. They just bought this firm. I mean, there was this firm WinAutomation, and they had, there was this program software program WinAutomation. There was this firm Softomative, and they bought this firm last year in May. So it's a software program that's been along for quite some years already. So it's not something completely new. So it's mature, I would say. Microsoft just bought the firm last year, and they now call it Power Automate. They actually took out some things that were in the original software, and they added, of course, new things to it that are more Microsoft-like. To call you one thing, for instance, one of the questions I got from other users as well is, can you start Power Automate Desktop from the command bar, from the command prompt, for instance? Well, this WinAutomation software could do this, and the current Power Automate Desktop cannot do this anymore. So they took out this functionality, actually. Might be that they will return the software again, but at this moment, it's not there. But of course, they added new things to it. I mean, working with virtual machines in Azure, for instance, that's the kind of thing they added to Windows Automate. So you can just actually start virtual machines on Azure from Automate. So you can, in the morning, you can run a flow that starts the machines, and at 5 o'clock in the afternoon, you can run a flow that closes all your virtual machines on Azure down again to save cost, for instance. Yeah. So this is what this WinAutomation software looked like. And this is the old software, so to speak. And well, we are going to show you the new version, of course, the new interface. And I will tell you, they are just like all the other Power Platform thing. They are just currently updating it very recently, very often, so to speak. So you will be surprised that there will be new things coming every week or whatever, just like all the other Power Platform software. I mean, they are constantly updating it. To put this software in perspective a bit, there are more tools, of course. I mean, you may have heard about UiPath. You may have heard about one of the other software programs that's on this sheet. But as you see, UiPath and Microsoft, they are both at the right upper corner of this quadrant. So they are, well, a bit of a winner kind of thing. So they are, this newly bought software is brought Microsoft right at the top level of the robotic processing market, I would say. this firm UiPath, for instance, you may have heard it because they went to the stock exchange. They went to the there is a public offering at the moment. So they went to the stock exchange last year, and at this event, this CIO of this firm, he actually said, "Okay, we will probably see the end of manual office work in the coming decade." And then he means that robotic process automation will take over so many manual tasks and offices that, well, he is he allows himself to tell this kind of things. Yeah. So this, okay. Well, let's get a bit more practical. How would you install Power Automate Desktop? Where would you get it? Well, you could have go to Google and just look for it, and just then you will find this website, flow.microsoft.com/desktop. That's one way of downloading the software. A second way of downloading the software would be going to your flow.microsoft.com website, log in, go to your flows, and to the, at the right upper corner of your screen in the browser, there will be the button install, just like I show you on the right print screen. You can actually install Power Automate Desktop from there, and you can also install the on-premise data gateway, which means that's a way to allow Microsoft to get out, to reach out to your laptop or to your local network, for instance, to share, to process files over there, or to get data from there, or get data from a SQL server over there. So those two software things, they actually work together. Yeah, but you don't need the on-way gateway. I mean, you can do it without the cloud at all, but I will show you how they are connected and what the choices are. Yeah, but you don't need the gateway to tell you right away. So you don't have to fear that Microsoft wants to be on your laptop. Power Automate Desktop can do a lot of very nice things already on its own. Okay, well, this is the way it looks. It is it's a Windows application, as I said before, and at the left-hand side of your screen, you will see all kinds of actions. So that's those 270 actions I already told you about, they are there at the left-hand side of your screen, and they are grouped in all kinds of groups. So you have a web group, and a file group, and a system group, and a Azure group, and a Amazon group, and all kinds of things, and we will use a lot of them. But this is the so at the right-hand side of the screen, you will see those actions. In the middle of the screen, you will actually, paint out your flow. And at the right-hand side of your screen, you will be kept informed about variables you are using and all kinds of other things that are in a kind of clipboard way. Yeah, because you can actually record your things. You can, for instance, say, okay, I want to make a record of my keystrokes or my clicking the mouse. And then at the right-hand side of the screen, all those steps that you are performing, just like the macro recorder of Excel, actually, all these things that you are clicking on or doing, they will be at the right-hand side of the screen in an overview. So you can use them in the flow again. Yeah. So, but this is just the first general impression of Power Automate. What I will now do is just throw a few sheets at you to give you a quick impression of all the functionalities that are there. And after that, I will, of course, demo this. Yeah. So what could you do with Power Automate Desktop? Well, you could start launching applications, and they actually have three different ways of doing it. At the left-hand side of the screen, you see the launching things, so you see all kinds of very familiar software programs that are there to launch. So it's very easy to launch Excel or Outlook or Edge or Chrome or whatever, so that's quite easy. Access is not there, Word is not there, so they made a choice somehow, but those software packages, they are special apparently in the Microsoft world, so those are there. But in the middle, you see there's also another option, and that's the option run an application. And this means that any exit that is on your system can be run. So as long as you know the path of this exit, whatever strange program you like, I mean, as long as you have the exit file, you can run it. Yeah. So that's a very interesting option. And at the right-hand side, you see that you can open things. And especially we as Access developers or SQL Server users, we are for opening connections to things, aren't we? So open SQL connection is just a way of pasting in an SQL connection string and then opening your database that way. Or you can open an Access database. So you can launch the Access application through actions. That would be one thing to do. But if you don't want to launch Access, but just want to to grab the data, you could just open a SQL connection to your Access database. So there are two different ways of working with Access within Power Automate already. Yeah. So clicking buttons, if that's the thing you want to do, you take the actions route and the middle route, the run application, and otherwise you do the SQL route. Yeah. So that's one of the things, launching applications. A second one is you can work with files. You can copy files, delete files, rename files, read from CSV files, write to CSV files, read from text files. You can wait for files to appear on your system. You can check if they are there. You can even offer a file picker thing. You can get a folder listing, or you can even make loops over files. You can say, okay, I want a loop over all the files in a certain directory and do things with those files. Yeah, so working with files is there in all kinds of nice combinations. There are very nice possibilities over there. So that's the working with files. The next thing is very interesting, of course, is working with the internet. So you can go to certain web pages if you want to. You can download files from the internet. You can invoke web services. Well, it's called invoke web service, but they mean, of course, well, working with web APIs in what way you like. So invoking a web service means you can connect to any web API you are familiar with PayPal, Amazon, anything you like. Then you have web automation. You can actually grab data from text pages. Yeah, you can even make screen prints of the web page if you want. And you can do web form filling. You can make Power Automate go to a certain web page, click on buttons over there, fill in data in forms, click on checkboxes, etc., etc., and then just post the data to the server. So that is very nice. You can work with the web as well, as you see. What's next? Well, you can record things. You have a desktop recorder and you have a web recorder. So you can actually just perform the task you would want to automate, and it will just list all those steps that you are making. Yeah. It can wait for things. It can wait for files to be there on your system. It can wait for processes in your window development to be ready. It can wait for certain texts to appear on the screen, or it can wait for certain hyperlinks or things on a web page to appear. I mean, we know probably how this works. I mean, you go to a website, you want to download something, you say, okay, you click a button and then the download file will be prepared for you. And then you have to wait 1 minute or whatever. And as soon as this file is ready, then there will be this hyperlink making it possible to download this. So that's the things that you can do with these options over here. You can wait for certain links, etc., to appear on the screen. Okay, next one. You can work with variables in Power Automate. You can actually work with just number variables, text variables, of course. But the very interesting things is you can also work with lists, which is something like an array, I guess, in VBA. So you can make lists of values. And one very nice thing is you can even make a variable of the type object, which is actually added to interpreted to parse JSON. So if you go to a web API and there will be some JSON returned to you, you can just say, okay, save this JSON from this web API in a custom object. And what Microsoft will do is will parse and read this JSON and make it available. You can just type things. If you want the third child of the root, you can just type this name. You can just say dot blah 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 dot blah 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 dot blah blah blah, and you just go down the tree within this JSON file. So there's all kinds of things that we don't know about in Access, but here it is. It will just reach one part of a JSON file and just so make it available in the form of an object. So this is an object variable, actually. Right. Next thing. You can actually click, or you can actually record things, as I said, but you can also pick UI elements. So you can just say, okay, here's my Access application. I have an okay button. I have a cancel button. I have a list box. I want to use those buttons in my flow. So you didn't say, okay, I want to collect UI elements. And at the left-hand side of the screen, you see an example of UI elements from a Windows application. at the right hand side of the screen, you see UI elements from a web page. So if you know some HTML, for instance, you see at the right hand side of the screen, you see A and span and A2. I mean, every website has its own particular way of programming the HTML, for instance, but all those things have names. So Power Automate is able to pick out exactly those elements by their name and by their type. So it will remember those. So the next time you can say, okay, go to this website and take this element called span or whatever, and then click it or right click it or whatever. So you can collect UI elements in either the web or the Windows development environment. You can do things with your mouse, move it around, press keys, etc. So you can just type and drag, etc. within Power Automate. You can do some text processing, splitting, joining text, parsing text, taking left, right things, replacing text, converting text to data and the other way around, etc. So all those text conversion functions are there already in built in Power Automate. You can even do some little programming. I mean, the Power platform is actually built for, well, they call it the citizen developer, isn't it? I mean, they say the people that are not really developers, but that are, well, intelligent enough to understand some abstract things and know the way around in some simple looping things, etc. So that's possible in Power Automate as well. As you see, you have if-then statements, you have case statements, you have switch statements, you can have loopings. You can say, okay, I want a loop from 1 to 10, or you can have a loop through all the files within a certain folder, for instance. That's the kind of looping that you can do in Power Automate. All right. Well, the last thing before we go into some practical thing, I mean, you can work with Azure, Amazon Web Services, and all kind of cognitive services. So the complete stack of artificial intelligence offerings of Microsoft, they are also there as a possible action, as a possible connecting point. So you could put you could take your text from Access, push it into a text analysis web service from Microsoft, and get a sentiment from the text back in Access, for instance. That would be the kind of thing that you might do with this. You can even use it to read OCRs. You can read images and get the text out of those images. What I didn't put in here, but they recently added a new option that you can actually read PDF files and extract images or extract text from those PDF files. Yeah, or even merge. If you have 20 PDF files and you want to merge them, there's also the option merge PDF. Yeah, you can do cryptography, compression, zipping, etc. And you also have all the old things like terminal emulation, command prompt programming, everything is there. So this was just supposed to be a overview, very quick overview of what it could do for you. Yeah, so I now really want to start my demoing, because that's the most interesting part, I guess. So I just close my PowerPoint now. It's enough of PowerPoint. I hope you don't think I did too much of PowerPointing, but now I will start Power Automate. There it is. I just installed this Power Automate desktop software. I have to tell you right away, you can use Power Automate desktop on your laptop. If you have an Office 365 account, I mean, you really need a Office 365 account, because Microsoft has connected this tool with the cloud. So I have to log in into the software. I mean, if I move this thing around over there, one moment. You see at the right upper corner of this screen, you see that I just logged into the software. And if I click here, you see there are all kinds of environments. I mean, if I go to the website, you would see those same environments. If I go to Power Automate online, or I go to Power Apps online, you will see that you have environments, so to speak. And you need one environment at least in the cloud. And you need an environment in which you are entitled to use Dataverse, because Microsoft stores all those flows that I have here on my laptop. It will store them in the cloud. Even if I don't want to start them from the cloud, they will still be stored in the cloud. If I now go to my Windows development over here, and I would go to my Power App development, for instance, I'm not going to talk about Power Apps now, but I will just show you. If I go to the Power App develop or to the flow environment, sorry, if I go to my flow environment online, you will see those environments here as well. And if I click this here and I go to flows, my flows, you will see that I have cloud flows over here, but you will also see that there are desktop flows. And you will see exactly the same list of flows that I had on my laptop. I will show you them, both of them. There we go. The order is a bit different, but as soon as I make a new flow on Power Automate Desktop on my laptop, and I say save, it will be saved in the cloud. So you need an Office 365 account with the possibility to have an environment with a DataFirst database in it. So that's technical prerequisite, so to speak, before being able to use Power Automate. Well, I started Power Automate. I just will start with a new flow. I say, okay, I want a new flow. This flow should have a name. So I say Denver Demo. There we go, create. It will be on my second screen, so I will just drag it to the left. There we go. Right. Well, this is Power Automate Desktop. What I can do now, I can just pick an action from the left side of the screen. For instance, one of the very nice thing, of course, in the Access Developer Demo is starting Excel. So I just type Excel. I just typed Excel. And then I will get all the Excel actions that are there available in Power Automate Desktop. And there you have Launch Excel. So I just drag Launch Excel to the flow screen, and it will now ask me some details. Do you want to launch Excel with a blank document, or do you want to add it with an existing file? That's one of the options I have. So I just say, okay, blank document. Do you want to make it visible? Yes. Do I want to load the add-ins? Yes, I want this. Okay, save. So now I have one step in the flow, launch Excel. Yeah. If I were to click on the run button, it would just start Excel now, right away. Yeah. I mean, very boring would that be. So I will do some more things before we test this. I could say I want to type something in Excel. So I just say, okay, I want to send some keys. There we go, send keys. So now Power Automate will ask me, what would you want to type in Excel? Well, I say, hello. Well, not the world, but I say, hello, Denver. And I could then say, okay, return. I mean, you have to get into this kind of coding thing. And then I could say, how are you? Right. Did I do the right sign? I need the echo. So, okay, save. So I have two steps now. Launch Excel, send keys. So I will just run it at this moment, run. And then you will see that the application will start. It will probably start on my other screen, but I will, yeah, there it is. It will start, it started on my other screen, but there it is. You see it started and it typed my text. So it did this. It did exactly what I asked it to do. Yeah. So I'm not going to save it. So this is the first impression of this program. You have actions at the left-hand side of the screen. You drag them to the right, to the middle of the screen, and you just enter some kind of, well, configuration things actually. So starting Excel and sending some keys is very easy, of course, but you can do all the other things as well. And I have some demo things prepared, of course, for you. So I'm not going to make all those things right away. But I will have some very interesting demos afterwards. I just showed you, or I introduced you to the way it works. So I introduced you to those actions. I introduced you to those things over here. And what you see at the right hand side of the screen, you see there are variables. Every step in a flow will actually produce or is able to consume variables. So for instance, if I go to this launch Excel, if I double click this step, you will see that it will just show me the screen again. But at the end, I didn't tell you before, but at the end it says, what is the variable that's been produced? So in this case, this variable is called Excel instance. So in the remaining parts of my flow, I can now use this variable to do something with it. Yeah. So for instance, if you would say, okay, I would need to read the first file from a folder, then I could fill a variable with the name of this particular file. And then later on, I could say, okay, delete this file or print this file out or whatever. So every flow step has the possibility to use or to produce variables. Yeah. I could even add a variable myself. You could also say I want a variable because, I mean, for instance, if you were to make a flow that goes to a website, you could say, okay, open website ABC, but you could also say I want to set a variable. And this variable is called new var, but then I can just type it here and I could say, okay, but this is not new var, that's very boring. It's the variable is called website. And if we do it the access way, it would be str website. And which website would this be? Well, whatever. I say Groningen, that's where I live, .nl. So this is just a variable, so to speak. And I could drag it to the top of the flow. So I could put all kinds of variables at the start for all the parameterization of my flow. And within any step, I could use those variables to recycle. So if I were to launch, the browser now, I could launch Edge, for instance, and then it will ask me, would you want to launch a new instance? Yes. And what's the URL? Well, I could type it in now, but I could say I click this little X over there, and I will use one of the variables that I filled before. So I have this variable website, and I just click it. And I say save. So I think I should improve this one because it should probably be something like this. Right. So if I run it again, you will probably see that I will go to the Groningen website because I filled this variable with this particular text. It is going to type over here and there it is. It's going to Groningen website. It did so. So that's very nice about Power Automate Desktop. You can have a very extensive variable usage. One of the other things that's very good to tell you right away, sorry, I'm going to close. One of the things that's very interesting as well here at the right-hand side of the screen is that you have the possibility to collect UI elements. Yeah. So if I had started Word, for instance, I have Word open at this moment. Yeah. So I drag Word over here. So what I could do, actually, I could say, okay, in my application, I want to be able to click on Word things afterwards. So what will I do? At the left-hand side of the screen, you see Power Automate. I click on this UI elements button. It will ask me now, okay, you are about to add UI elements. Well, at the moment, you don't have any in the collection, but there's a button, add items. So I can click add UI elements. And now everything I touch might be something that I just record. So if I want to press the bold button or whatever, I now press the control key on my keyboard and I say, I click on the B. I can also click on the, and look at what's happening over here. You see it recorded the bold button. I could also click on the italic button, for instance, or on the copy button or what. I mean, everything I touch now would be recorded. So to speak, I have a collection at this moment. I have a collection of UI elements that I would want to use in my application. So I say done. So at the right hand side of the screen, you see the things that I clicked on. They are, of course, from Word, and you see what's over there. It says, okay, it came from the new Word document window. So if I had started Word within my application, I could have pressed the bold button. Yeah, or I could have pressed the italic button. I will show you how to use it. I just want to introduce you to what's possible. You can just pick UI elements from a Windows application, or you could pick UI elements from a web application. Yeah, right. Well, having said this, I'm not going to save this particular Denver demo. If I would have saved it, it would have been saved in Dataverse, as I told you before. So it would pop up in the website as well. But I will just close this flow. And will not save it because I have some things prepared, of course. So I have some very nice demos to show you. And there are quite some things that are very interesting for XS users, I guess, because I do some SQL Server stuff as well. First of all, I start with a very simple thing, which is this one. So I have a flow already there, and I could run it from here. I could pause it from here, or I could say, okay, I want to edit it. And that's what I want to do. I want to show you what's in there. So I edit this particular flow. Well, this is a very simple thing, but this thing will download a file from the internet. So just to give you some impression of what's possible. I said, I want to go to a particular website. I want to get this website. I want to get this page. I then want to save it to disk to a particular, and I want to save it in this directory. Yeah, so that's the first thing I added to my flow. Go to a website, download the complete page, save it as a file on the ctemp directory. That's step one. Step two might be, okay, then launch Outlook in this case. So I launch Outlook. And in the third option, I say, I want to send an email from this Outlook instance. So at the top, you see this variable, which holds the Outlook instance that I started a few steps before. I have to give in some credentials, of course. I mean, which account from Outlook would I want to use? So in my Outlook, of course, this account is known. So I just tell Flow, use this account. Send an email to this particular address, and I would want to attach an attachment to this email. Well, and there's this other variable. I mean, the step that downloaded the file from the internet, that downloaded the file, created this file, and stored the name and the path of this file in this particular variable. So now I just say, okay, please get this file and attach it to this email. So if I now just say run, it will just do this. So in this case, it has made this mail, and in a few seconds, there will be a mail in my mailbox. And if I go to my ctemp directory, there it is. The mail is there. Look at this, it just arrived. And if I go to my ctemp directory, you will just see that it's there. So it's the file at the top. There it is, DEFCON. It just downloaded the file 13 minutes after 7, which is right now. So it really did what I asked it to do. Download a file, start Outlook, send the email somewhere. So that's one flow I think is very interesting to a lot of people that send a lot of mails. And more interesting thing might be this. Connecting to a web API, getting some information from this web API and doing interesting things with the response from this web API. Right. I can zoom and to show you a little bit more what's there. So the first step would be just to set a variable, web API. That's a variable. So I found a website that is where you don't need credentials to get a Bitcoin rate. Just an example. I don't have Bitcoins or whatever, but it's just a nice example. So I have a variable of this web API. I then say, okay, please invoke this web API. So go to this web API, get a response back, and store this response in a variable called web service response. Then in step five, because step four, I just made it inactive. So I started with displaying it just on the screen, but you can also make a flow step inactive. So step four is inactive, won't be processed. Step five says, okay, save this web response and turn it into a JSON object. And then I say display message. So, I mean, I want you to see this JSON so that you know what I start with, because all the other steps after it will just get parts of this JSON. For instance, in step seven, I say, okay, please, from this JSON object, just give me the part that's called time. Yeah. So in the beginning of this JSON file, there's a date and timestamp saying what's the current date and time of this particular Bitcoin rate you are getting. And after this time, there will be a British pound, a US dollar, and a euro course of bitcoins. Yeah. So if you look at step 8, you will see that it's very subtle. I said, okay, please take the object, go to the part that's called BPA, go to the part of this BPA that's called UR, EUR, and from this particular part of the JSON file, give me the field rate float back. Yeah. So it will just take a part of this JSON file, and then I say, okay, well then in step, it will display it on the screen. It will then write it to a JSON file, etc., etc. So, and then I, at the end in step 12, I will then open Notepad, and I will show you the file that he just downloaded. So that's in a quick overview what this flow will do. And perhaps it's very nice to have a look at this. So I'll just run it. Yeah, so the message is on my second screen, but here it comes. This is the display message. So you see, this is the JSON that came back from this web service. And you see there's a time entry at the beginning. And if you take some time, you also see that there is a BPI part in this file. So it has actually two records. You have a BPI and a time. Okay. So if in step 7 I say take the time, it will show me 15th of July 17 as the time. And if it will display the euro rate, it will show me 26514.5403. Because that's the euro rate of the Bitcoin at this moment. Okay. There it is. It has displayed the time, you see, step 7. Okay. It will display another message. It will display the message, the Bitcoin is worth 26514, as I said before. And it will then write everything to text. And on my other screen, it opened Notepad, and there it is. And I did this more often. So I started this on the 8th of April. So if I go to the end of my file, I will have the current rate. So I appended all those downloads to a text file. So every time I run this flow, it will be appended. So I did this right at this moment. And I did this afternoon just to test it, as you see. But I did this also on the 1st of June, for instance. So I get a history of Bitcoin rates this way. If I were to run this on a regular date, a daily basis, I would have all those dates. And now it's very interesting to see what's happening at the right hand side of the screen, because all those variables, you can see what the content of those variables is. I mean, if I run the flow once, I can just have a look at all those variables. And if I hover with my mouse over them, I just get an impression about what the current value is. Yeah. So I think that might interest a lot of you, because working with web APIs is somebody's work, is work for most of us, I guess. I mean, we all have to deal with accounting software or banks that have web APIs, or all kinds of online services have web APIs. And with Power Automate Desktop, it's, well, as you see, it's quite easy to actually do this. And if I just focus on the info web service, I mean, if you have worked with web APIs before, you know, some of them want you to specify the data type you are posting to it, or getting JSON or XML, or some of them need custom headers, they need an authorization key, or they need a bearer code, or they need some kind of special thing. Well, you can put it all in here. I mean, there's a header section, there's a request, but you could paste your own JSON in here. If you want to post things to a web API, you can just put in the JSON over here. Yeah, and you can then save the response. So you can update data, and you can just log for yourself through this last page over here, last option over here. You can just document that you did this, for instance. That would be one of the use cases of this. Yeah. Right. So this is, I think, very interesting things. Getting things from a web API, saving things, and etc. Right. Then another very interesting thing, I guess. We all know the problem of having to go to websites, I guess, and downloading particular things from this website. For instance, I will show you something that I have done myself with this API. If I go to the Flow environments, Microsoft Flow online, I have a flow. Sorry, there it is. I have a flow that runs every day. It sends me an email every morning at 10 o'clock what the weather will be the next morning. Well, this is just an example of what you could do, but you might be interested in downloading the results of this flow, if they succeeded, yes or no. So on the website of Microsoft, you can have actually the option of pressing all runs over here, and then Microsoft will just collect all the runs of this flow down here. And it will have the possibility to, I pressed all runs, and you have the possibility to click get CSV files at the top of the screen. If I click this myself, I will have to wait for Microsoft to generate this file. Yeah. So what I will show you that is Power Automate can then just wait, just as I do. It can wait for this download file hyperlink to appear. And as soon as this hyperlink download file appears, it will then click it. And you can see if I click it manually, I have to save it, etc., etc. Well, let's have a look at what Power Automate could make of this. I could go into this flow number 4. Right, here we go. So this flow will do the following. It will just go to my website. So I must say I already, of course, logged in because I connected the logging into this website to my Windows account. So I don't have any login things in this flow. It will go and enter into this website with my credentials, of course, which I stored on my laptop. So that's why there's no logging in. But I move instruct Edge to go to this particular website of this particular flow. It will then wait for this website to appear. It will wait for this button show all runs to appear, and then I will click it in step 4. It will then in step 5 wait for this get CSV command to appear, and as soon as it's appear, it will be clicked. And if I click this get CSV file, it will wait for this complete file to have been produced, and then it says download file on the website, and it will wait for this text to appear, and then it will click it. And then it will even get the href, it will get the element, the link of this particular hyperlink, it will get it from this website. And so this is the address of a file. So at step 9, I can just say, okay, get this reference, this href, this web address, this URL of this particular file, and download this particular file and store it in Ctemp. And then close the browser, and then just open a notepad and just show me the file that you just downloaded. Yeah. So you want to see this happening, I guess. So there we go. I say run. You will see it do all the things that I just said it will do. So I just wait and see what's happening. So it's clicked on get CSV. It's yellow on the screen, you see. So it's now generating. It will wait for the generation to be ready. And as soon as it says download file, it will move to step 8, etc., etc. And then it will display a message in step 10. And I will show you what this message is all about. This is the exact address of this particular file that I want to download from the website. So very nice. It says I then want to close the browser, and then I will want to open Notepad and display the file. So this is the file it just downloaded from the internet with the history of the flow that I just wanted to see. So if you have, for compliance reasons or whatever, if you have to download particular things as a proof of being a website, being online or whatever, this is the way to go. I mean, you could just let Power Automate do this. You can check sites, you can download files from there, you can download log files, or you can even use FTP commands within Power Automate to download or upload that kind of file if this is not the way you want to go. So this particular flow might be interesting as well, downloading things from the internet. Well, I think that it's time now to move into more database kind of things. For instance, CSVs. We all know about comma-separated files and all kinds of external software programs exporting CSV files that we then have to import into Access or SQL Server or whatever. Yeah. So I have a flow that has a very interesting capabilities. I can say, okay, please make a new variable of a type list, and it is called list in this case, but okay, I don't get the first prize in naming conventions, I guess. So the list is called lists. Then I say, okay, please get all the files from a particular folder. But if you look a bit to the right, you will see it has to match asterisk.csv. So it will take all the CSV files from this particular folder. I then added a loop saying, okay, I want you to process all the individual files. If there's 2 or 200, you have to process all of them. You have to read the content of this file and add this content to this list. So at the end, I have one variable called list with the file contents of all those files that were in this folder. Step 7, then I say, okay, please remove duplicates just in case there were duplicates in the file. And then I say, make one file. So write this variable list and make it a CSV file. So there will be a CSV file called merge.csv. It will be written. And I played around with this a bit. So I then started reading it right away. I mean, this is not completely, doesn't it make sense probably in your eyes, but I just wanted to play around what's possible. So you can write CSV files. You can then read them again. I mean, one of the things you could do with reading and rewriting them again is you could read them with, say, a comma as a separator. And you could then rewrite it back again with a semicolon as a separator. I mean, you all know that there may be problems with separators in comma separated files. I mean, it's depending on your locale, on your laptop, etc., and what you have as a decimal sign. So that might be one of the things you could do. Read it with one parameter and write it back with another one. So that's the way that you could use comma separated files. And if I go down, sorry, a bit. If I go down a bit, you will see an interesting thing, because in the end, you will see I have an SQL Server statement. And now you think, well, what's this? What's this all about? Where does he insert this file into? Well, this is the first thing that's really interesting for database people, I guess, because I say, okay, please insert this into a certain table. Insert this into a table called Bitcoins, and you insert this from this particular file. So this is a file that I just created before. But if I take a look at the details of this last step, you will see that I opened a SQL connection over there. So if I double click this last step, you will see that I had a connection string added. So in this case, I have a connection string over there connecting to a local SQL server on my laptop. Yeah, of course. And there's a database called test database. And if I look at my SQL server and I can show you that this database is there. So there it is. And at the moment it's completely empty, as you see, but the connection string to this particular database is over here. So in this case, I put the connection string right in there. And then you can just add a SQL server command in here. Yeah. So if I were to run this, it will take all the files from a particular folder. It will merge those comma separated files into one file. And then at the end, I will say, okay, please take this comma separated file with all the sub files in it and insert it into SQL Server, please. So I will just run this. And there it goes. It will display a message. It's just for information purposes. I will show you what's in there. This is the current content of this comma separated file. So there's some names and the number of Bitcoins those people have. Right. Now, if I return to my SQL server and I would say, okay, please show me what's in the table now, then you see those records have been inserted. So in this case, I just use Power Automate to merge comma separated files together, put in exactly the separator I want, and then at the end just use one SQL command to just insert this into the database. So in this case, I use a connection string to a SQL server, But I will tell you, you can also use a connection string to an access database. Yeah, so you could do exactly the same. Yeah, so I will show you that then as the next thing. So this was a SQL Server example, but I could show you how to work with access. So I have flow number 7. I don't think I will show you all of them because we are already 1 hour on our way. Are we still on schedule, George?
Yes, we're doing great. We've got another 30 minutes, so carry on.
Okay, I feel very comfortable in doing this. So access, there we go. I'm just going to edit this flow. I told you at the beginning, you can have two separate options working with access. You can open the access application because you might want to click on buttons or do whatever you want in access as an end user application. That's one thing. Or you can say, okay, I just want to use access as a SQL based backend. So as a database server, so to speak. Yeah. So in this case, in this particular example, I'm using access and I'm also using a SQL server in a SQL way of doing. So it's a bit like the other one, but it's still a bit different. Look at step 2, for instance. In step 2, I have a SQL connection. I open a SQL connection and I used the Microsoft ACE OLIDB connector. And as you see, I just open a database called access bulk insert. Well, that's the directory and the database is called Bitcoin. Yeah. So in step 2, I open a access database as a database, not as an application. So just the tables and the queries, etc., I can access them. So what I will do now is I will get the same CSV files as before. I will rename them one by one to a particular name. But in Access, I have a linked table connection with this CSV file. Yeah, I mean, we all know what I mean with this, I guess. You can connect to a CSV file. And then I have in Access, I have a action query that appends the data from this CSV file through this linked connection into a table. So I just move along all the CSV files. I rename them one by one to this particular name. This particular name is called import.csv. And in Access, I have a linked connection to import.csv. So if there's 5 files, it will rename 5 files to import.csv. It will then use the action query insert to insert those records from this table or from this link table into the database table Bitcoin. And as you see in step 8, I can use the word exec. So an action query within Access can be executed just like a stored procedure on SQL Server. Yeah, perhaps I should show you the Access database so that you know what I'm talking about. And then I will run the flow. So I have a database over here. I will start the file now. So here it is. This is the Access database. I have a table called Bitcoins. I have a linked table called import, and it is linked to a file that's called import.csv in this particular subfolder. And I have a query, an append query, which is going to append everything from import into table Bitcoins. I mean, this is the normal access stuff, yeah? Well, knowing this, I will show you this table has those data in it. I will just delete those data for this moment. So the database is completely empty now. I will now run this flow. It will get the comma separated files. It will rename them one by one. It will then trigger the stored procedure. I would say that it will trigger the action query within Access. This will append all the data. And at the end, it will close Access again. So if I now open Access myself, and I would open this Bitcoin file again, then those records are all there. And you see, I did it in two ways. I did it manually, and I did it with a SQL Server instead. If you look at my flow, I just inserted them twice. I inserted them with this insert query, as you see, at step 8. I just used the insert query. And in step 10, I just said, okay, I want to type plain SQL. So I just tried this out as well. So I just can say, okay, I want to have a SQL statement being executed in my connection. So that's why they are there twice. Yeah. So this is the way to work with Access as a database. Yeah, to use the views and the tables within it. But then there's one more thing you can do. You can use Access as an application. You might want to press buttons, et cetera, et cetera. Yeah, and I will show you that as well. I will just use skip this number 7, but I will go to my flow 8. And I will show you the Access database before. I have an Access database in which I want to register vaccinations. So you can imagine that you have this kind of an application over here, and you can say, okay, I have some vaccinators. So I'm on a certain place in Groningen, and I have a vaccinator called this one, and using AstraZeneca. And then I say, okay, I want to add some data. And this is an application, an Access application. Well, I will show you a flow that will do the following. It will start this application. It will press this new button. Then you will see this screen pop up. It will type in a name over here. And it will also add the date to it to be able to check if this is working okay. It will then click the close button. And it will also do something else. It will first of all find out how many people were there before I did this. So normally it will, if I run the flow afterwards, it will say, okay, there are 35 persons in this database at this moment. And at the end of my flow, I am also reading this text field again, and then there will be the number of 36 in there. And then at the end, I say, okay, there are 36 people in the database at this moment. So that's what I'm going to do. I'm using Power Automate to click on buttons, enter data in my database, tell me that it succeeded, and then close the database again. Yeah, right. So we have 35 persons at this moment in the database. So what did I do here? I will show you. As you see now, I used run application. I did not use SQL Server connection. I said run application because I want to start the software package access.exe. I add the argument which particular database file to open. And then in step 2, I say, okay, please read something from the screen. So on my screen, there is a label called TXT person count. So I just told it, get this particular UI element and get the text that's in there. So step 2 just will go to this element and take the text, copy it. Yeah. So this will be stored in a variable. And then later I can use this variable to check if everything went okay. So in step 4, it will press the new button. In step 5, it will go to this. That will get this. Again, yes, it will, step 6, it will get the current date and time. In step 7, it will type person X and it will add this current date time to it. So this will be entered as a new name of a new person, so to speak. It will then wait for 10 seconds so that we can see that it actually did this. It will then click my command button 13. As I said before, I don't get a price for right naming of properties. So command button 13 is the closing button of this new vaccinator screen. So it will close the form. It will wait for 4 seconds. Step 12, you won't see it at the moment, but step 12 is inactive, so it won't close access. So it will go to step 13. It will then again check what's the current number of persons in the database. And then I add an if-then statement. So if the number before and the number after is equal, then there must have been something wrong. So then I display this one message. And if I go down a bit, if it's okay, it will just tell me, okay, yes, the number of persons is 36 now. So this will actually start access, do some data entry, and tell me that it succeeded, and then return. So let's give it a go. Run. Right. It will now read this 35. Ah, it's on the other screen. It's on the other screen. There it goes. Yes. You see, it entered this person X. It entered the date and time of this moment. I said, wait 10 seconds now so that we can all check that it did this. And then it will press the close button. Yes. There is 36 now at the screen, you see. And at my other screen, and I will drag it to the left now, there was this message box. Oh, it was too late. Because I said, after 3 seconds, you should let this button, this dialog box disappear again. But it said on my screen, number of persons is 36. So you could actually use Power Automate to test your application. You could say, okay, if you change something in your Access application, you could say, okay, I have a test script. It should do this and this and this and this. And you can log everything that's happening on the way. And you can just at the end say, okay, it was successful or it wasn't successful. So you can press all the buttons. You can type all the things you want in your application, which means that Power Automate can really help you test your Access applications. Yeah. Right. That was number 8. Well, we also want to have some questions, of course, at the end. So I'd like to show you one more thing, which I think is personally very interesting, which is something completely different. It can read OCR. So if you have an image, you have a scanned image or a photograph or whatever, and you want to read the text from this particular image, you have an OCR engine within Power Automate Desktop. Yeah. So if I show you this particular folder, I will show you what's in there. So I will show you the image that I'm about to read. So I go to this and then I have OCR. Look at this beautiful picture over here. This is a text. It's an image, as you see. I can't type it. This is really an image. But Flow can do the following. Flow can say, okay, I also have an OCR engine on board. I can extract the text from this particular image. And I can display it on the screen if you want, but I can also write it to text. And then I can open Notepad so that we can check if it succeeded in reading the OCR from this particular image. Right, so I'm gonna run this one. Yeah, there it is. On the other screen, it says, I have read this text from the image. Okay, very good. Thank you. Okay. And then at the end, it will open Notepad and there's the text from this image. Yeah. And I told you before, I mean, this is already very powerful, what you see here, but I told you before, Power Automate can also communicate with all the artificial intelligence services from Microsoft. So I have seen people do the following, take an invoice, for instance, as a PDF, push it into a service, into an artificial intelligence model, which you once trained to read those invoices and get the data back and insert them in the database system for you. Yeah. So it could be done this way, but you also can use artificial intelligence versions of this same procedure to read documents or scan cards or whatever, or read photos and get the texts or the images from there. Yeah. So I think that was my demo part. I could go on and on and on, but I guess there might be questions on all kinds of things, or there might be particular wishes about what it could do or not could not do. So is there anybody that wants to?
I have a quick question for you. I noticed that you had some what look like label hints in blue. So for example, use SQL or run action query in Access. Are those labels that you can put into your flow to kind of help you know what each step does?
One moment. You said.
So for example,
okay, I will just open this one, for instance. Yeah. Yes, it will tell you in this kind of summarized way what this particular flow will do. If you double click it, you will see all the details, but this sentence you are talking about will just display the most crucial things. So for instance, here at the bottom, yeah. You will see in blue the particular parameters that are used in this particular step.
If you go to the other flow, the access import, bulk insert, I think there you had,
bulk insert,
they look like labels number seven. I'm wrong.
Here we go. So
executing an action query and access on number seven above, is that a label that you put in?
Ah, this is a comment. Yeah.
Comment. Okay.
Yeah. I just said I want a comment there. Yeah.
Oh. Very nice. Thank you.
You can add comments there. Yeah. And those things, those are the parameters. So if I double click it, you will see all those details in the display. So that's a, What I didn't mention is that there's also on error trapping. You see on error, every step has on error possibilities. So you can just say, okay, I want errors. What to happen? Which error should do what?
This is amazing. This is really interesting to me in terms of automating access testing.
Yeah.
Many of us have a lot of clients, and those clients are usually pretty small shops with little or no IT departments, no formal testing organizations, and you roll out a new test version to them and they essentially do monkey testing.
Yeah.
And so I'm wondering if as a developer, we could create test scripts using these flows and then export the flows to our customers to import and essentially give them a test suite.
You want to take this flow and then give it to them, so to speak.
Yeah.
Yeah. There's not such an option in this particular desktop version. I could go to the cloud just to have a small peep. Because this is, you see, those are those things online now at this moment. I can just have a look. Yeah, look at there. You can have a save as thing. Mm-hmm. And you can also have a share. So I could share this one with others. That would be the way, I guess.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, I see great possibility there. Because I could, you know, provide them with the flows for, you know, testing specific areas of the application. So if I've made changes to a specific area of the application, I can recommend to them that they run this flow, that flow, and the other flow.
Yeah.
Kind of thing. And then the other thing is, I presume that the flows allow for prompts for user input.
Yeah.
So as they test, they would be prompted, you know, for an account number or whatever to test against and be able to input that and then run from there.
Yeah. Yeah. You can have input boxes, et cetera.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. What you also could do is you could say, okay, I make a comma separated file, or I could make a Excel sheet or a database table in Excel and to loop through this. That would be another option. If you would want to test 10 accounts or 20, that would be the next option.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay.
You can just loop through the records within the table. Say, okay, I want to check those customers. Please use those customers for the test. You could just check them in Excel, I guess.
Or you could have a table in your front end for your testers, and you could have that. You could prompt them in the beginning to populate the table with the numbers that they want to test against.
You can loop through records in a list or whatever. Yeah. So I showed you that I have read a CSV file and put them in a list, and then you can make a loop over the items in this list, for instance.
Right.
Yeah.
This is awesome.
Yeah.
Question.
Any other questions?
Yes, I have one question.
Yeah, please.
For the If an Access database or an Excel database, Excel is opened by someone else, will the flow be able to run and insert the data?
No, the flow should do all its work, so to speak. Well, that's to say, you can open an Excel sheet yourself. And in this, I clicked on bold and italic, etc. in this one particular file, so it will remember that this file was on display. So I guess if you open a file yourself with this particular name, and then you say, I want to pick UI elements from this particular file, it will remember which file, which title in the window it was there. So you can open a file yourself and then trigger the flow, because it will find out that this window with this particular title is open, which means you open the file yourself, and then it will be able to insert things in this particular text. Yeah.
So, for example, if you are running the flow to insert the data and someone else is opening the data based on in the back somewhere, different person, will be able to insert the data at the same time with the person who's opening it manually.
Yeah, in Excel it's a different thing, of course. Then you need to put on this multi-user option, of course. Yeah, Excel is not a multi-user database, of course. So.
Okay. And then for Access,
that's multi-user by design. So you can use as many flows entering data in the same database as you want.
And for Access, must the file be in a share location,
if more people were to use it, I would say put it in a shared drive somewhere, on the network.
Okay, right. Thank you.
Right. I have opened a new flow just in case somebody wants to know if something can do. I mean, I did only show you a few things over here, so, but I can just click. But maybe somebody says, okay, is this in this particular action also possible? There's so many. This is, for instance, new PDF. Reading, writing PDFs, merging PDFs, everything is there. Azure. Creating subscriptions, creating virtual machines, snapshotting files, snapshotting virtual machines on Azure. And all the cognitive services from IBM, Google, and Microsoft. Right. There's a hand from Phil.
Yes, great presentation. It's kind of mind-blowing what we can do now. Question that maybe I missed in your presentation, but can you initiate these actions directly from, let's say, Access or a SQL Server Store procedure?
No, that's the problem. That's what I pointed out in the beginning. The old tool had the possibility to start flows through the command line, which would open up the possibility to use a shell command in Access or so to do the work. But they removed this particular action at this moment. So it's not there yet, or it's not there anymore. That's what a lot of questions are asking for this. So you are asking about this, actually. Can you use a powered automate desktop from the command line? And it can be done. So you can't start it from outside. The only way to start a flow from outside is if you go the cloud route. If you pay this license and then you enable this gateway, and then Microsoft can start the flow for you. You then start it on a scheduled base. You might say, okay, every night at 3 o'clock, Microsoft should press the button, and then it should start the flow on my machine. That's possible.
Okay. All right. Thanks for repeating that. I must have missed it. But
there's one question I would like to ask. Is there between this our desktop app and a combination of task scheduler and Bash script?
It can't be started from Power Automate from the task scheduler either. Well, you can start the application, of course, but you cannot give it an argument. So, say start flow X or start flow Y. No. So somebody else made a joke and said, okay, then you use UiPath to start Power Automate. But that's a joke. Yeah, no, it's, but it might be that it will be coming back again. I mean, if enough people ask for this, they will, I mean, I don't see why they shouldn't enable this, because it's so practical. I mean, not everybody wants to go to the cloud, and not everybody wants to be paying money for triggering things that you can also trigger yourself on your own laptop. Yeah. But currently, that's the only way to make it happen.